morning, everybody. I'm so excited to be here with my friend, Dr. Schaffner. I just have such great respect for all the work she's doing. And if you've followed her or seen any of the things she's doing, she's been prolific lately too with podcasting and sharing the world of lymph. Today, that's going to be our topic. So super excited to have her. I think we did some other interview for a program she did, and it just really resonated with what she's doing. And I think we have the same kind of purpose in the world to help people with healing and continue to bring the information out. So just a little housekeeping, you can find all my blogs, resources, anything you need, sign up for the newsletter at jillcarnahan.com. Any products we have at drjillhealth.com. And you can find this recording wherever you listen to your podcast, iTunes or Stitcher, and also on my YouTube channel where we have now like over 80 interviews. All the videos are there and you can watch them. If you just search Jill Carnahan on YouTube, be sure and subscribe there so you don't miss any episodes. But today I want to introduce Dr. Christine Schaffner. She's a board certified naturopath who has helped thousands of people recover from chronic and complex illness. I think that that's one of the things I realized when we first talked is a lot of us in this field deal with these most complex chronic patients. And I love it. I know she does as well, but it tends to be the ones who've tried other things and been other places and really not always had the best luck, especially with our conventional system, which serves its purpose. But when it comes to complex chronic mold and Lyme and some of these things, I don't think it does us a great service many times. So I'm super excited to pick her brain on lymph drainage and some of the remedies and things that we can do around that. She's done online summits, her Spectrum of Health podcast. If you haven't caught that, please be sure and tune in on her podcast as well. And I think we're going to do a recording so that I'll be on your podcast in a few months as well, which is exciting. She goes beyond biological medicine, pulling from all systems of medicine and healing modalities, helping patients reclaim their wellness and reveal their brightest light. I love that because it's really about that. She's got a lot of credentials. I won't belabor the point, but you can find her at drchristineschaffner.com. And you can find her bio, you can find her resources. But welcome, Christine. It is so glad to have you here today.
Oh, thank you so much for the warm welcome. And I just have a lot of gratitude and admiration for your work. And I'm so excited that we get to do this interview today.
Me too. So I love to start kind of with story. And I would love to hear just a little bit about how did you get into medicine and naturopathic medicine? How did you get your start? What's your story?
Yeah, absolutely. So I, you know, grew up in Virginia and I was really raised in a family of medicine. My dad's an oncologist and hematologist, and my mother has a nursing background, and she went through the education route. So she did a lot of teaching and she was a director at a hospital. And so I was really exposed to the world of medicine, and I always like loved science and loved biology, and I was really good at it. And I, you know, could memorize everything. And, you know, so I just had that affinity, and I, you know, started, especially in my high school years, really trying, you know, when we used to go to bookstores, go to the Barnes and Noble section of the, you know, the spiritual, you know, wellness type section. And can you hear me, Jill? I'm like, of course, right now when I'm doing this, there's like this leaf blower out the thing. So that was just, I'm just making sure that's not recorded too much, but can you hear me okay?
I can hear you okay. Yeah, there's okay. A little sound in the background.
I know. It's like, okay, you know, it's like, you know, 4 o'clock, someone's, you know, leaf blowing, but anyway.
Yeah, back no to, worries.
Yeah, so I know this is live, right? This is real time.
Exactly. It's totally.
You know, yeah. So I had this really, you know, curiosity for, you know, what we would call the mind, body, spirit, right? And so that led me to an exploration and meeting different people. And I found out about naturopathic medicine through a family friend. And when I found out about it, it just really clicked. It felt like this is, you know, the medicine I've been searching for. And, you know, I had to go through a little bit of my own process and journey. I graduated from University of Virginia in about 2003, and I went right out to Bastyr. I'm 22 years old. Wow. And really thought I knew, you know, things about health, and it was just like complete culture shock and so much new information. And, you know, I did something very not like myself. I actually decided I would take a year off because I just was trying to, you know, my ego, my East Coast ego was still like, should I be a medical doctor? Should I be a naturopath? Like, I couldn't really quite settle in. And it was really interesting during that time that I took off. I actually spent time in Colorado, and I lived in Aspen for a little bit. And in that time I met, like, it was almost like foreshadowing. Like I'm, you know, when I was in my 20s and working like 4 jobs to be able to live there. Right. Yeah. So exactly. I connected with the Aspen Center for Integral Health at the time. And they, you know, they bring in all these wonderful people, and it's like very, you know, think tank that community. And so, you know, I learned about mercury in the mouth, and I had learned about, you know, colon cleansing and raw food at the time and detox and, you know, just different innovative strategies. And so it was just all this foreshadowing. And so I found my way from, you know, going from naturopathic school, taking a little break and coming full circle, and really coming back in 2007 to Bastyr, and kind of everything, it was timing for me and everything clicked. And I felt very passionate that I really wanted to find a path to really help the, like, the true cause of why people are sick. And when I was at Bastyr, one of the first weeks, we had this brown bag lunch, and Dr. Louisa Williams, she was there, and she had just come out with her book, Radical Medicine. And I just was like, you know, whatever she's learning or whatever she's, you know, teaching, I want to learn. And that's what I want my practice to be. And so her book, it was before Kindles, it was like that big, and yeah. I would just cart it around. And, you know, it's really the, you know, the textbook of how I practice a lot of, you know, she talks about biological medicine and interference fields and, you know, all of these, you know, things. And so that just sparked me on my journey. And, you know, out of school, I got a great opportunity. I've learned a lot about complex chronic illness. And as I'm sure you're very well in touch with our patients, teaches every day, you know, and, you know, I think this is, you know, a really important time to bring this medicine to the forefront. So people don't have to suffer so much, and people don't have to spend decades trying to figure out what's wrong and going to, you know, dozens of doctors and spending tens of thousands of dollars. Like, I really admire your passion as well to just like, how do we just get this information out to more people so they really understand, like, it's not a random event that's happening in their body. There's many reasons of why we end up with imbalances, and just make that more of the mainstream conversation.
I love that. And I love how you can, I love hearing people's stories, because we all talk about it. Like, there's this soul healer piece, right? And clearly out of family history, I had no medicine in my family at all. I come from farmers and nurses. Nurses, I guess my mother was a nurse, but not no medical doctors at all. But there's still, like, now I look back, I'm like, oh, I was a healer. I intuitively, and same with you. And what's neat is we come to this path. And now my training, very different conventional medicine, which is great for foundational for trauma or heart attack, but then it fails us a lot in most every other area. And again, like I said, I have such respect for my naturopathic physician friends, because you guys teach me so much about lymph and about bowels and about colonics and about, and we'll talk about all that today. And even the fact that there's energy outside, I mean, obviously we measure EKGs with energetic, so we know this is real. It's science-based, but there's a lot of energetic fields that affect our health too. So I'd love to talk a little bit about that. So first of all, what kind of patients do you mostly see? I'm sure the complex chronic, but give us a little framework, and then let's go into kind of how you would address that. And of course, we're going to get to the lymph system.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So I see, like, my average patient has seen a dozen doctors, you know, they've tried a lot of things, and they really have these multi-systemic illnesses, right? So they are, unfortunately, you know, plagued with a list of symptoms of insomnia, anxiety, depression, brain fog, chronic sinus issues, a lot of digestive issues, a lot of circulatory issues. So, like, cold hands and feet, or kind of stagnation in that area. You know, this just feeling of, you know, being unwell, you know, and you and I know that you have your health journey, and I'm so in awe of where you are today with that journey, you know, but, you know, we do, like, you and I live a life, like, you know, of a dream. Like, I do things that I love every day. And the thing that breaks my heart about a lot of my patients is these amazing souls, but they really, their bodies are so sick that they really can't do much other than, you know, survive each day. Exactly. And so, you know, that is really what keeps me going, is really holding them in the space of our medicine and really having that vision for them to not only recover, but also to, you know, live a purposeful, meaningful, you know, life that I think we all are on the planet to do. And so I think that really is kind of the why, you know, again, like, you know, it's very rewarding to treat people and get their suffering, you know, alleviated. But I think it's like, we need to think about, like, the more people who go through this journey and this understanding of how we're really wired to heal and how we're so connected to the natural rhythms and nature and, you know, the planet, that, you know, that just has such a ripple effect. Right. And, you know, that's, those are the people I see. So I see those people again, and they're not, you know, one label, one pill, and they're better. That's not what we do. Yeah.
I love that. And two things that you mentioned, I think, so key. Number one, it's not just healing, which we can do, but it's getting them to thrive and find their purpose and meaning. And there's such a difference in, I know I've been doing functional medicine for about 20 years, but in the last maybe 5 years, I've done my own personal healing in, you know, trauma work and somatic work and some of that. And that's been more profound than any sort of even supplement or diet or any of those functional basics that we do, even lymph drainage, right? Like this awakening, we could call it. And you talk about, that's another way to say what you just have been saying is, how do we allow that patient not only to get well, but to awaken to their real purpose and calling in life. Mm-hmm. And that's where it gets so exciting, right? And honestly, I feel like exponential healing happens when patients start to realize, you know, why am I here? What is my purpose? What's my joy in life? How do I serve in what I've been called to do? So I love that you mentioned that, because that's really like the next level of healing. And sometimes doctors just stop at, okay, the physical healing's done, then that's it. So love that. What do you start with? Do you start with the detox? Do you start with drainage? Do you start, give us a little like map of kind of how you might start with a complex chronic patient in the clinic?
Yeah. It's a great question. And I think my answer always evolves. And, you know, just in, as you, I know, are well aware, you know, everyone that comes in the office, we treat really individually, right? But we have kind of a map and a thought process, and it really depends where people are at. But, you know, I look at it from a couple of different ways. You know, we do all the lab work and all the functional medicine work. And then I do a lot of bioenergetic assessment, which allows me to connect with their physical body and their energetic body to see really where to prioritize. And I find that a lot of patients, depending on where they are, we look at and identify what we call interference fields. That's a term in bioregulatory medicine to look at, okay, they've seen all these doctors, they're really smart people, they tried a lot of things. Why aren't they recovering? Why aren't things clicking? And often a layer that is often overlooked and underaddressed is this idea of interference fields. And interference fields can be scars. So scars can actually affect lymphatic drainage. They can affect the fascia. They can hold emotional trauma. They can affect the nervous system and the energetic body. And believe it or not, scars can really impact our ability to heal. And they can be this island of turbulence in the body. So we look at scars. We look at what we call foci, are these hidden infections in the body. So these reservoir of infections that are silent and often not like the typical like hot red swollen infections. They're the silent, you know, in the background brewing reservoir of pathogens that are kind of holding our patients back. So that can be in the mouth. So a lot of, you know, dental issues we address. I don't know about you, but I see in a lot of my patients what we call like a tonsil interference field. So the tonsils often become chronically inflamed, infected, and they are such a big part of the lymphatic system and our immune system. And so that can be
a pocket of pus sometimes.
Totally. I know. You look in there and you're like, sometimes, oh, wow. And so, you know, that can be a focal infection. The sinuses can be a focal infection too. And so these are areas that are the body of infection that the body cannot clear. And they tend to be a home base for different opportunistic pathogens that then have, they can enter the rest of the body through the lymphatics and the circulatory system and the nervous system. And so that's a big place of where I start is like, okay, have interference fields been addressed? And then we of course look at, you know, are they in a toxic home? I also, you know, we don't necessarily start there unless it's a very unique situation. Start just opening up and understanding, is there a significant trauma history? And from childhood to even, you know, the trauma of being sick too, you know, we think about all these past experiences, but, you know, being sick sucks, you know, and it's really traumatic, especially if you've been.
Illness can be one of the biggest. And I love that you're saying that, because my history was like, trauma was like for those people who had been horrifically abused and again, we were very stoic German kind of family. I grew up and so I was like, don't talk about that. Now I realize we all have trauma, right? We all have, and we can have wonderful childhoods and we still have trauma around just growing up and being kids and being, you know, and parents, no one's perfect and no child is perfect. And so I love opening this up, because if we open it up and make it less stigmatized, then we can deal with it. And we all have little bits of that that affect our health.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, trauma, you know, I think the more that we learn through, you know, our mentors and our, you know, these pioneers studying how it affects us, it's, you know, I think it's just as much as like mycotoxins and, you know, Borrelia and Bartonella effect is, you know, trauma really is, you know, a toxicant, or it has an effect in our physiology. Yeah. And not to go down that rabbit hole, but I'm happy to. It's like, yeah. you know, the trauma affects all these parts of us, right? So it can make us, you know, can affect us epigenetically. It can live, I believe, you know, a lot of these memories that often are not conscious anymore can be stored in our fascia, you know, in the connective tissue. Yeah. And that's why somatic therapies can be very helpful. That's why neural therapy can be very helpful. And, you know, it's like the mind can be somewhere, but the body, as the book, you know, the body keeps the score. And so that's a big one. You know, I think that's a really big piece of the puzzle that, as you said in your own process, and I see that in patients, it's like the supplements are important and all of it's important, right? But the real work, I believe, is this, that work, you know, is really to,
I couldn't agree more. I think like really opening people up to that piece, that like, for me, it was exponential healing in that realm versus mm-hmm. all the other stuff I'd done for the previous, my whole life. Mm-hmm. One thing interesting, I want to hear how you assess bioenergetic fields, but I just mm-hmm. want to mention for a personal story, we talk about these hidden things because mm-hmm. for me it was profound. I remember when I talked to an acupuncturist and realized the meridians of the two teeth I had root canals in were related mm-hmm. to the pancreas and the breast and the colon. And I looked at my history. I had breast cancer at 25. I had Crohn's at 26. And I had pancreatic insufficiency a couple of years, maybe 5 years ago. So my whole health history was in these root canals as far as meridians. And when I realized that about 5 years ago, I thought, oh my goodness, I need to have them pulled. Mm-hmm. And while I do believe those affect most people, not everybody, if you have a strong, robust immune system, it may be a minor issue. I unfortunately don't. So it was, and I just wanted to say, because I had psoriasis prior to pulling these two, within 7 days of getting the last tooth out, my psoriasis went away, never to come back. So like that for me was a big aha, like, oh my goodness, they were affecting me. Now, the other part of the story is I had two cavitations from my wisdom teeth. These just last year I got done. And I had always struggled, especially around mold with cystic acne. Like I always, my skin just was always manifesting the liver. And let's talk about that too, because I want to know your perspective, liver and detox and skin. But my skin, I could never hide. And I looked horrendous at times with the mold and the acne. As soon as I got those cavitations done, I don't know if I've had one breakout since. Like I have the most clear skin I've had in my whole life. And I realized that those dental things were massively affecting my system.
Oh yeah. No, thank you for sharing that. And that's a really common that I see in my patients too. It's like the, you know, these infections and the toxicants and the oral microbiome have so much to do with our physical health. And so if anyone is listening out there and they feel stuck, like look in your mouth, you know,
that's exactly. I was like, what else have we thought about this?
Yeah, I know. That's actually what Louisa had said at the brown bag lunch. She's like, what is the first thing you know, do with a patient? And we're all like, you know, clean up their diet, whatever. And she's like, look in their mouth, you know? And so that always just, I feel really fortunate to have had that imprinted. And I had my own dental journey as well. You know, I had, I fell on my face when I was in second grade and broke my two front teeth. And, you know, they were capped. And then in high school or college, I realized that there was a little abscess and they were root canaled. And I, you know, when I looked at, you know, all of these things, you know, I had some thyroid stuff, I had some, you know, the pituitary kind of hormonal axis, you know, kidney stuff. And, you know, I just had this awareness that if I don't, you know, get this taken care of, it could really lead to other problems down the road. So I'm just hoping, yeah, the word gets more about this. Yeah.
Oh, I love that. So bioenergetically, how do you assess someone? Do you have bioimpedance? Do you have what kind of technology or ways do you assess? Because I'm so fascinated by that.
Me too. And I feel like a student, but I, you know, have learned so much. And again, you get the feedback from your patients, right? It's like why we do this is because it works. And so I use a couple of different tools. So I use autonomic response testing. So that's something I've been using for 11 years. And then I also use a tool in the office called the AO scan. I've only honestly been using that for about 2 years, but I feel that it is really clinically relevant. I've been exposed to a lot of Russian bioresonance technology in the past. And so when a friend brought this to me, I was like, okay, I'll just look. And let's just see. And like, you know, you just kind of, you know, you have that fun, like, okay, scan. And then I have all my patients scan just in the beginning, just to see like, okay, like what is, what's the pattern there? And it was really wild. I mean, I really saw, you know, a lot of significant markers that were imbalanced from the AO scan that I could see in the lab work too. Wow. You know, so they correlated. Yeah. So I've learned to trust that tool. So I have all my patients scanned, which is really nice because you can do that remotely. remotely. So in the realm of telemedicine, it's just a Russian bioresonance technology, and it basically sends resonant frequencies to the body. And then the body says, okay, what's in balance, what's out of balance. And then they give healing resonant frequencies and then says, okay, what is still in, like what's been balanced and what's out of balance. And then you kind of see what the key issues are. It also has this really cool thing, Joe. It has a program called Inner Voice, where you talk into the machine, and essentially it's this program, it's an algorithm that finds high and low tones in your vocal cords and your sound, and they've matched that with different subconscious themes and patterns that people tend to have when those vocal tones are out of balance. And then it gives you music to essentially balance and, you know, create, you know, more healing where those deficits are. And so it's wild. And again, I know that sounds
weird. I'm really like my mouth, as you can tell, my mouth is a gift. So Christine, about 5 years ago, right after my divorce, I called the awakening when I really had to deal with my own stuff and really went deep. And I worked with a neuro-linguistic programming coach. And one of the things she did was she treated me somatically, and I saw changes in my voice. Like, I have recordings in my facial expression and in my voice. And even now, if I look at old recordings, or if anybody who's a voice expert looks at that, I am dramatically different in tone and musicality and still changing. But I realized then, oh my gosh, these trauma patterns affect our voice. So what you're saying makes perfect sense to me. Like even speaking voice, I'm like, this is crazy that NLP could change my voice. Yeah. But if any of you look at my old stuff, you can see it's very different.
Yeah, no, I love that. And, you know, our voice is, you know, is sending out this, you know, beautiful sound, you know, and frequency of our inner essence, you know. So of course that's going to change as we change, you know, and, you know, become, you know, a whole. No, I love that. I love that. And so I use AO scan, and it really goes down even deeper. And I really feel that's the future, Jill, just to, you know, the future is if we can have more of this in conjunction with all that we do. You know, the thing that I love about the AO scan is people can have it at home too. And so when you're dealing with a chronic illness, it's the confusion and uncertainty of the day in and day out of like what to do, why am I reacting to this, how do I do, you know, that kind of takes some of the mystery out of it. So I've had a handful of patients who've started to use it at home, and I'm really, really excited. They have a little thing that you can put supplements in, and then you can send the supplements you need. So it's just, so that's, I'm just in this passion.
So loving this. And, you know, we know, okay, and I don't do protocols either. I do individual, but even individual, like, I think this should work, this should work, this should work. But there's this million of variables with the genetics, with the environment, with their energetics, and things that should work don't always work. And I don't have the ability energetically to tune in like that machine, or like you maybe, to say for you, you know, what does your body want? So I love this system and what you're describing. And I'm sure the autonomic training, that's part of it too, like before.
Yeah. You know, kind of like my process is like people do lab work, you know, we'll do specialty lab work. We'll scan them. If they're in the office, I have a biowell camera as well. Dr. Beverly Rubik introduced me to that. And it's a biofield camera. It's a gas discharge visualization camera. And so it uses Carlene photography and this technology to map the biofield and see kind of where there's imbalances in, you know, the field of energy that we emit. And so that can look at patterns, not only physically, but also emotionally. So we have all those tools. I also, I kind of consider it a bioenergetic tool, even though it's more kind of in the realm of biological medicine. But I have the regulation thermography as well. And so that's looking at the autonomic nervous system. So, you know, I don't always do all of those with everybody. We have all of that access. And then I take all that information in, and of course the clinical history. And then I do autonomic response testing. And that's a way for me to, you know, hone in with that individual, you know, and to find out, you know, where the priorities, where the plan is, because, you know, ART and any other type of either applied kinesiology or, you know, some type of biofeedback exam, you know, there's, of course you can perceive what stress and how to imbalance, but it's only as good as like the information we have too, right? Like we have to be the computer to digest it. And so all of that information helps me to really try to hone in, because as you know, there's like 30 things to treat the bile ducts. Like, okay, well, you know, let's see which one is going to
exactly. So I love that, because it's such a really personalized approach. Now, what about this? Is maybe, I don't think it'll be a hard question for you at all. I 100% understand what you're saying. I believe in it. I think it's the future. Like, I am all in, and I love that you're doing this, because in my practice, I don't have as much access to those tools. So love it. But what I've run into, even in my realm of understanding this, trying to explain it to people, skeptics, right? The engineers, the scientists, and there's nothing wrong with that. I'm an engineer by trade. But how would you explain to a person who's just like, this doesn't make sense? Now, well, you and I know, and I'm the biggest believer of any that you're going to hear. So I'm all in. But I want to hear, how would you, because I'm sure you've come across patients like, what is this? How does it work? Yeah. We know it works. But how would you describe that in layman's terms of how the energetic feels and how you can actually test this, like the autonomic response stuff? Tell, like, what would you say to a skeptic? Because I know that I've had patients that are like that, and I want to, you know, better know how to explain it.
Totally. And there's like the short version, the long version, I think, maybe just to kind of like bring it out for a minute. I hear you. And even I was, you know, as I shared, I was like, open to energy medicine and all of this. And then you kind of get delved into practice and do this. And you're like, does this work? Does that work?
Yeah.
You know, because you know, you have that healthy skepticism.
You do. Yeah.
And you get that reinforcement of seeing the results time in and time out. And, you know, I think we have a lot of understanding ideas of why and how it works, but I think we have to always be open to, like, we probably know this much, and there's only going to be more and more information to understand, like, why, you know, why and how this is working, right? As we learn more about the body. But, you know, I look at it in a few things. I always love to use this term biofilm, Jill, when we're talking about this, because, you know, you can search it in PubMed, you know, it's definitely a, you know, it's a documented phenomenon, and, you know, it kind of combines all of this, right? So we know, as you mentioned, we have the EKG and EEG.
We can measure this.
All these fields. And, you know, the heart has the strongest electromagnetic field in the body. So it's generating this, you know, field that's measurable. And the biofield is essentially this toroidal shaped field of it's electromagnetic, but it also, they say it's the subtle energies too. And I think those are that's the biophotons, that is the light body, you know? And so I think that it's the summation of this electromagnetic energy. So the electrical fields and the magnetic fields and that information, and then, you know, the biophoton field. And so we know that all of our cells emit light and we can receive light. And that is also very well documented. The fun part too, Jill, not to skip ahead, is that we also emit and respond to sound. So there's a term called biophonons, and people are studying the music that cells make, and actually cells that are healthy make beautiful music, like really resonant kind of beautiful music. And then cells that are dying or cancer cells make this screeching music. This researcher in UCLA found this out. So why I share that is that there's all of this like biophysical nature to our structure. So we know we have this biochemistry, and then we have these fields of information and around surrounding us. And I think there's almost like this tipping point too, that people can hold this information a little bit more because our cell phones work and so it's like, okay, it's not a far stretch. I mean, how do you think your cell phone works, or how your wife, you know, it's fields of information, right? And so I try to set that out. And then, you know, I also, not to get maybe too out there, I also, what helps me to understand this is that within, okay, we have this biofield of all the things I shared. And then there's this whole idea of what we call the electric universe. And the electric universe is a different viewpoint of the universe, that we have this, that like space isn't an empty vacuum, but it's this, this fourth state of matter called plasma. And then there's this ether. And this kind of describes how you and I are connected, even though we're, you know, far away. So this information travels, you know, through this unified field, or however we want to, you know, whatever we want to call it. Right. It's the unified field, it's quantum field, but we're sitting in the sea of energy and information. Yeah. It's just what I want to say. And then we're highly interconnected, right? And that's it's a spiritual message, and it's really a physics message, you know, too, that we are all interconnected. So when I work with a patient, you know, there's a lot of things happening. So yes, we can perceive a change in muscle strength based on a physical substance coming into the field of the patient that creates a stress response in the body that can tighten up and create muscle contractions or affect the fascia. So that's, you know, a lot of the premise of these forms of testing. But there's all these other interactions that I am curious of always exploring. It's like there, and when I test someone, I actually use a surrogate arm. And then when you think about it, we have three people, we have three biofields, we have that connection to the unified field. And there's this openness of information that we're connected with, you know, so not only am I reading the changes in muscle strength and this pattern that is, you know, tested and reproducible, but we're also opening ourselves up to this other, you know, like way of informing us what the patient needs. And like you, I'm sure, like, you know, you're typing, you're like, okay, the patient needs this and this, and then you get out of your brain and you go over to there. And then, you know, my assistant or my resident will be thinking the same thought, you know, at the same time, you know, and you're just like, where is that coming from?
I love that you're saying that, because what I've realized, again, I've done this a long time and I'm very analytical, left brain dominant by nature. But as I've embraced, and feminine masculine can be any, it does not male or female, but I think we can also think about it as masculine, more driven, analytical energies versus feminine, creative, muse-like, those kinds of things. And what I found, again, which is what you're saying, it sounds like with your story, you've been very in touch with both. For me, I was very, very driven, analytical, and I had to actually shift. But what happened was the most profound insights, understanding, and basically miracles as I've embraced that. Now I still use the analytical. I love that. But that's like actually an old analog computer compared to the supercomputer of the intuitive, right? And when I open myself to that, and then I always back it up with science. So it's like beautiful, just like you. But the intuition, what it brings me as far as information for the patient's well-being or what they might need, I don't even know where it comes from most of the time. I'm like, thank you.
Totally. Yeah. So you're so talking and this whole other thing comes out.
Exactly. And I'm like, great. And I now trust it. And then again, I use science and I make sure they're getting, you know, I mean, there's all kinds of checks that are still analytical, but what I find in that field of subconscious and intuition, and again, if we call it feminine masculine energies, that's just one way to think about it. It's so powerful. It's so powerful. And things that I could never come up with in my analytical brain, the insights and the healings and things, it happens there. And I'm always just like, wow, how lucky am I to get to be part of this? Because it's not about me. It's just letting myself be a conduit to that wisdom from the divine.
You know? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I'm so aligned with what you're saying. And I think, you know, as we sit with our patients who've been, you know, struggling for so long, and we talk about these complex chronic illnesses and how it takes time to heal, which is true, you know, it's just what it is. But why I also am really passionate in bringing more and more of this work into my clinic and into my realm is like, I want patients to get better way quicker and way faster and way easier. So it's like, you know, that's where I really feel, and I've seen it, you know, and I've, it's not my everyday experience, but I see a lot of it and more of it. And I want to invite more of this conversation and more of this awareness within, you know, the clinical setting. So, you know, we can be open to, you know, not to sound whatever, but like more the miracles, the more the, you know, spontaneous healing, the more the, you know, what I know that we're capable of.
Exactly. Yeah. And I love what you're saying too, resonates so deeply. And I'm sure those of you listening, because back in the old day when I was super analytical, I felt like you had to struggle, you had to push, you had to strive, you had to beat yourself up. This old mentality of the force and the struggle that it took to achieve something or to heal or all those things. When you go into this other quantum realm or this more creative energy or this intuitive, again, for me, it's a very spiritual practice. It happens with such ease that it's almost like, really, it's that easy. And again, it's just amazing to me, like if we could really tap into that space and teach our patients to do the same, it's so much easier, right?
Yeah, totally. Totally. And even if like you're, you know, cause we all have our, you know, our stuff that we have to go through to get here. And it's like, even if like, you're like, I'm not sure. It's like, there's no harm in just exploring. Just like try life and, you know, this awareness, you know, just try it on and see what happens, you know? And so, it's really, you know, again, I feel, you know, it will evolve as I evolve and as
it's really a trust and surrender. Yeah. You're right. Cause when we have to hold all the control, all the struggle, all that comes from like feeling like we have to force, or we're way in the future, way in the past. But if we're present this moment, you and I, and then we're trusting that whatever we need is going to happen in the right time. It's so easy. And it really does happen. The things we need, the resources we need, that if we trust in our ability to, when things come our way, know that we can figure it out. It's just so much easier. So let's shift to lymphatics in our last bit, because this is, first of all, I love this conversation. Love it. And I'm seeing some comments rolling in as you guys are commenting. Lots of people are loving it too. So this is great. Let's talk about lymph though. First of all, give us just like a real quick, you know, 2-minute crash course in the lymphatic system, why it's important. And then we'll talk about like strategies to actually address it.
Yeah, absolutely. The lymphatic system is another, passion of mine. And again, my patients teach me every day the importance of this. And many patients who walk in our offices, they have congested lymphatics. You know, that's just a really big part of recovering somebody with any chronic illness. And so the lymphatic system is just this body-wide network. So it's a network of what we call lymphatic capillaries. We have lymphatic vessels, we have nodes, we have organs, and the lymphatic system is really highly interconnected to our circulatory system. So we have our heart that pumps blood through our arteries. So the blood flows into the arteries and into our tissue spaces in what we call capillaries. So the capillaries are these like micro, that's where the microcirculation is happening. If you all have heard, like, my microcirculation is not working, it's like in the capillary system. And so what happens in that capillary system is that oxygen-rich blood is kind of basically part of the fluid in that space is leaving the capillaries and bringing nutrition and all this good stuff to the tissues. And some of it returns and goes through the venules to the veins, back to the heart. But a lot of that fluid stays, and a lot of that fluid stays in that tissue, and it starts to bathe what we call the extracellular matrix and bring oxygen and nutrition in. And then it also helps to shuttle waste out of that system. And then in the extracellular matrix are these lymphatic capillaries that start to drain that fluid. So that interstitial fluid becomes lymph. And then that lymph basically carries its way back through vessels, encountering nodes, and making its way back to the thoracic duct and the right lymphatic duct. And, going back to that extracellular matrix, like, that is where all the action is, I believe, in our patients' story. So, when you think about what's going on there, so there's the cells, the cell membranes, encapsulating the cells. There's all of these structural proteins like collagen and elastin and the fibroblasts and the mast cells, are hanging out there. Borrelia loves to hang out there. It loves to, eat and degrade collagen. Viruses hang out in there. Heavy metals that we get exposed to because of their charge lock on to like the proteoglycans. Mycotoxins can hang out there, viruses, parasites. So this space is not draining regularly. It can be highly congested and can be full of contaminants. And that can affect basically cellular communication and the ability for the cells to get the trash out. Yeah. Right. And so why we, do our lymphatic therapies is really on the microscopic level to drain that space and keep that space moving so that we can have really, really wonderful cell communication, keep those pathogens and toxicants out of there. And that's also where trauma hangs out. So there's the structured water around the collagen that, through this wonderful biophysicist, her name is May Wan Ho. She's passed, but she studied structured water around the collagen and the acupuncture meridian system. And that's where, when we, do neural therapy or craniosacral or somatic work, that's why you have a memory or something when you're working on that tissue. Yeah. But
yes.
So it's all in there, So that's a really important space to, keep moving and keep draining, and a big part of, where we work. And Dr. Rob Cass, who he's the creator of Physica, and he has a great book. And he says, it always sticks in my brain, by draining the lymphatics, we're essentially, we have the opportunity to change the terrain of in the cell and our epigenetic expression, right? So by doing these therapies, we have a profound effect on our health.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh gosh, I love that. And I love that you kind of gave us an outline. I see so many patients, and specifically, like you said, with Lyme and mold, which we see a lot of them who have congested lymphatics. How would you know? I mean, clearly everybody could use lymphatic work, but what would be signs and symptoms of congested lymphatics? Like, how would you know from a clinical perspective?
Yeah. It's kind of like, just, again, nothing's 100%, but it's pretty much 95% for a lot of our patients, but it's a lot of symptoms, right? So, from headaches to migraines, to nasal congestion, allergies, a lot of gut dysbiosis, bloating, pain, edema, cellulite, acne, all of these things. And then there are key areas in the body, too, that are kind of lymphatic areas. There's a lot of the cervical lymph nodes that can get congested, especially in our patients. Underneath the clavicle, there's the, on the left side, there's the thoracic duct, and then the right lymphatic duct. These areas can get tender. Women, breast health is lymphatic health, right? So if your breast, if you have fibroadenomas or fibrocystic breasts or even cancer, there can be lymphatic congestion, you know, the armpits or the axilla, that can be a huge area. Any pelvic issue, any reproductive issue, ovarian cysts, fibroids, probably even endometriosis, prostate health, you know, a lot of lymphatic congestion can happen, you know, in the pelvic floor. Gut dysbiosis, of course, can lead to, you know, lymphatic congestion. And then, you know, a lot of our patients, especially with Bartonella and other, you know, infections, their lower extremities can be full of symptoms from neuropathy to, you know, poor blood flow to edema to, you know, being very cold. So a lot of these symptoms are a lot of these underlying causes, the outcome is lymphatic congestion.
That makes so much sense. And I love the image of Bartonella. There's many, many causes, but in my clinical experience, I'll say that the most difficult lymphatic cases are usually related to Bartonella.
Yes. So totally agree there. I agree.
So what would we tell us about what would you do to treat lymphatics and any, I want to hear about your products too, for sure. But is there anything people can do at home or lymphatic drainage kind of stuff that we can do?
Totally. There's so much you can do, right? And it's just awareness is the first step. Mm-hmm. If you're struggling with a chronic illness, that whole idea about scars that I talked about, you know, scars can, you know, create blockages in the lymphatic system. So if you can see somebody for neurotherapy, or you can do different topicals I can talk about, or even photobiomodulation to help, you know, ease some of that stagnation in the scars. So scars are really important with the people who are struggling with chronic illnesses, especially also the tonsils, as I mentioned. So making sure that lymphatic tissue is being treated. I use a lot of different topical sprays from I love the Beekeeper's Propolis, and I like the Megacidin and different gargles with ozonated water. So those are kind of, you know, those hidden areas that could keep your lymphatic system, you know, congested if you're not addressing scars and the tonsils, in my opinion. Also the sinuses. And again, if you have any dental infections, that's going to just be that chronic, you know, assault to the lymphatics. However, there's lots you can do. So movement is really important. So even if you're really sick and you can't obviously go walk miles, just get up and move your body. And my good friend Gina Bria has also talked about how, you know, not only that are we moving the lymph, but the fascia, which is the connective tissue, what we call the saran wrap around muscles. It's way more than that. It's actually this fiber optic communication system in the body that delivers exclusion zone water in our tissues. So basically you're moving water and hydrating yourself by moving. So that's really important for lymphatics and movement. And then there's different ways to kind of do self-lymphatic drainage massages. One, you know, again, you can use your hands and you can really, you know, the lymphatic system is all interconnected. So if there's a block in one area, it's going to affect distant areas. So you want to think about these key points, especially, you know, the thoracic duct and the right lymphatic duct, opening those areas up. There's some lymph nodes again along the neck that a lot of our patients, you know, are congested with. So, you know, opening this up and then draining. Also the breasts, you know, and so using along the breast or the armpits. And there's a lot of tools. So I love the gua shas, the facial gua shas. I think those are really fun to use at home. Dry skin brushing can be really great. You always want to go in the direction of your heart and then open up upstream before going downstream. So if you want to drain this arm, you basically want to open up here, then here, and then go here so that the lymph has somewhere to go. So those are some, you know, home tools. There's also the vibration plates. There's the rebounders. There's home little vibration things. Yeah. And then there's lots of topicals. So I've created two products that I really enjoyed. They work well. One is from a product line called Lymph. It's Lymphagem, and it's an oil infusion, and it has different some of my favorite herbs plus essential oils. So like red root and cleavers and nettles and red clover, and then it has heliochrysum, geranium, and frankincense. And so I have people put that on at like their body at night, especially because our lymph is draining a lot at night. And then I have this other product that I collaborated with Dr. Ruggiero. It's called Lymph Flow, and it's just a little bit more, it's stronger. So it's really good for those really congested areas, and it helps. A lot of our patients have brain fog and all sorts of things going on in the brain. So we want the lymphatic system in the brain to drain really well. So we open this up at night. And then there is BioPure has their detox deodorant. So you can actually also use that at night around the like axilla and the the lymph nodes in the groin area, like kind of the pelvic floor, kind of bikini area, also the bottoms of the feet, it can be very helpful for. BioPure also has a breast health tissue, what do they call it? Femtox, maybe, I forget what they call it, but you know, for people who have a lot of breast congestion or recovering from explant surgery, you know, that can be very helpful. And then, you know, castor oil packs can be very helpful. There's so many tools, and then we use internal, you know, herbs as well. You know, there are a lot of drainage remedies and then different, you know, herbal combinations that we use. So there's a lot of things to do. Also patients who are chronically ill, often you've had your lymph system congested for a while. So if you're in an area and if you can connect with a clinic, getting like a wonderfully skilled practitioner who does lymphatic drainage massage, that can really help things get things going. And then my good friend Kelly Kennedy introduced me to equipment called the Flow Presso, and it's this like compression suit. So it's compression, infrared, and they call it nano vibrational technology.
Wow.
So
yeah. That's cool.
Yeah. And it's so relaxing, and you know, you go into the portal. It's really nice. And so that's a really wonderful piece of equipment to use as well. So there's so many things to do, Jill. One thing too, I guess, to note for our patients, some people, when their lymphatic system is really congested, mm-hmm. and we get it moving, they can feel flu-like for a little bit at the beginning. Mm-hmm. And that's not a sign that it's bad for you. It's actually a sign you really need it. So what I do is I often treat people with binders before and after mm-hmm. lymphatic therapies, and then also immune support. So whatever you're taking, just take more of like your antiviral or, you know, Lyme support. And then you can navigate that. Ozone can be really nice before and after as well. But don't, you know, just it was moving too much. Don't like be afraid of it or, you know, be deterred from it. Just go back more gently with more support, and that does get easier. It doesn't happen for long.
Yeah. Oh gosh. That was just a wealth of knowledge. Oh my gosh. So many things people are asking for. So what we'll do, if you're listening, wherever you're listening, we're going to include links to Dr. Christine's products and anything else that she mentioned. We'll make sure and get from you everything that you mentioned so that we can share that with everybody who's listening. I see some hearts going up. People are glad to hear that. That was like, wow, that was awesome. No, truly, that was great, great overview. And so many things, like you said, there are so many things that you could start with at home. And then some of these other remedies. And all, like you said, all that junk just coagulates in that's a terrible word because that's blood, but you know, tissues. And really, this is part of the healing. It is so fun to talk to you, Dr. Christine, and time goes so fast.
I know. I can't find
it. Yeah. I know, right? So it's drchristineschaffner.com is your website.
Yes.
And are your products actually on the website?
That website will kind of direct you to everyone.
Perfect.
My clinic is called Imminence. And then we have our store is called Hypothecary. So that we have a lot of things there as well. So.
Awesome. I'll make sure people have the links. Thank you so much for sharing your heart and soul and spirit and all the wonderful things you do. It is just a treat to talk to you.
Oh, thank you so much for having me on your podcast. It's always lovely to connect.
It is.